Today, we're going to be doing something a little bit different because we're not actually here as Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. We wanted to really fill you guys in on something that we've been baking up as an open source project and that was announced at LinuxCon about a month ago. So we really wanted to get out, we talked to the Linux world about what we're doing, and we wanted to get in front of more of the networking-centric audience and also give you guys an idea of where we're coming at with this new project, which I'm hoping will give you guys a lot of inspiration, a lot of thoughts, and a lot of questions. So typically, I'm the smart guy, but I'm just not qualified to be that smart guy today. So I brought my smart guy, who is Michael Zayats, and we will definitely be handing over to him at a certain point where you can drill down into any particular part of the microcode that you possibly could want, and he will be able to answer those questions. So if you guys want to play Stump the Chump, I think you'll lose. So what is OpenSwitch? Why OpenSwitch? So what we looked at is, the whole disaggregation of the white box switching, Oni boots, all this stuff. You guys are all aware of this going on in the marketplace, right? Cumulus Linux, PK8, Big Switch, all these things happening where we're starting to take the traditional model of a full stack network vendor who provides you have a SKU, here's a box, here is all the code you need to run that box, all the features. Most of them you have to actually add on additional, licenses to get access to all the features, not with all vendors, mind you. That model's starting to break. We're seeing really this is pushing driven from kind of what we call the unicorn companies up top, where they're looking at, the Googles, the Facebooks. They're looking at what was being delivered by the traditional network vendors and just found that we weren't agile enough for them. We weren't able to deliver what they wanted. And in some cases, we were just delivering too many bugs. Right, they wanted a stripped down version of code that would do what they wanted to do the way they wanted to do it. And so that's been happening a few years. We're aware of that as an industry. So this is really a way that we looked at what was out in the industry and said, why don't we really create a project and work with not just HP, but other vendors. So you can see kind of the list there. So we've got Acton, Broadcom, VMware, Intel, a bunch of fairly large players that would bring together and create a truly open source with access to all the source code project that anybody could contribute to and anybody could use. Right? So one of the things, if I was in your shoes, which I ask you guys to start putting the questions out and really aim them at Michael, not me, this is a project that HP is here talking to you about. Feel free to ask us the questions of how do we make sure that HP is not in control, right? I know as an industry, we've kind of had these questions of do you trust a network-led open source project or a vendor-led project? Maybe, maybe not. So I encourage you guys to ask all those questions, right? We can really drill into any of the hard things that you want to look at. So with that, I am going to hand it over to Michael, and you're chief architect of pretty much the platform, right?
Of OpenSwitch.
Of OpenSwitch. So if you guys have any questions at all, we'll go through kind of the architectural. We've got a live demo scheduled for you guys to see what actually, what's the user experience. And then a little bit at the end, we're also going to go through how to get involved. So one of the things that I really encourage you guys to do is to look at what the project is, go look at the code, see how you can get involved, see how you can play with it. Contribute fixing documentation, if nothing else. Right? You may not be a full-on programmer, but you can still be part of this experience and start evangelizing it and pushing it forward if you believe in it.
So my name is Michael Zayats. I'm actually just 1 year at HP, and I joined exactly to actually do this kind of project. Before that, I was 10 years at Cisco, and before that, it was security, denial of service, and other companies. So we started actually developing this project. We actually got full approval kind of January, February timeframe, and we started actually building the team. So we started from a team of about 4 or 5 engineers, and right now we have inside HP we have probably 80 engineers right now working actively on OpenSwitch, and another bunch of about 100 engineers joining very soon, just from inside HP as well. So we designed the architecture the way that we, we have experience from other places, and we have people from many companies. And we wanted to go over after the architecture that has the central state database. We know that it's good, it's stable, it works well, it has very nice properties. And you probably know quite a few architectures like that in the market. So if you look at the diagram, you will see that at the middle, at the very center of the diagram, you have this OVSDB server. The That's the state database. Everything is inside the database. Configuration inside the database, statistics, status, everything is there. Actually, we are going after very hard modularity in the sense that different daemons, they are not allowed to talk to each other. They're only allowed to work with data model, which is in the database. They publish stuff into the database, and they subscribe to different things. And it's the same database that you're supposed to know from OpenSwitch. It's exactly the same database, stable one, works well, provides very flexible way of subscribing to different elements. And so if I'm fan daemon and I'm interested in temperature, I will subscribe just to the temperature information, and they will receive these notifications. So database is in the center. Everything talks to the database. Nothing talks to each other. You can see that we have very few things inside the kernel. Basically, the entire operating system is in the user space. And our basic feeling is we don't want to push things into the kernel, complicated things in the kernel, stuff like SDK. If you put huge things, you push it in the kernel, and you destabilize the system at the end of the day. So what we want to do, we want to put everything in the user space. Actually, in our project, we didn't make a single line of change in the kernel itself. We use Yocto, so we have different things coming from Yocto. But we, as OpenSwitch, we didn't change anything inside the kernel. You can see on the right side, you can see another very important piece of the system, which is OPSSwitchD. Now, the name, if those who are familiar with OVS, the name will be very familiar. It's like OVS vSwitchD, and it's not a big surprise because it's actually derived code from OVS vSwitchD. It's using the same code base, and it's using the same OpenFlow agent inside, just in case, because next step we will connect OpenFlow to the system. And what is interesting here is that in Open vSwitch, in OVS vSwitchD, there is a very native layer of hardware abstraction. Those who know OIF protocol providers, NetDev providers. So there are many people coding to this hardware abstraction layer. So our driver layer is basically an extension of hardware abstraction layer from OpenSwitch. And right now when we talk to different vendors, and they're asking, okay, what's your driver interface? It's all from the same one as OpenSwitch, just extended. They say, okay, we have developers. Right? So we'll put this developer and this developer and this developer because they already know how to work with this interface. So we have this abstraction layer, basically, inherited from OpenSwitch, and we already created a driver for the most prevalent switch, which is Trident 2-based. So right now, you can run this image on 5712 from Acton. Completely, it works. It's being tested continuously in our labs. So we have driver for OpenSSL, for the Broadcom switches. We also have another driver that runs on top of the container, Docker containers. So we actually started having multiple drivers so we can make sure that the interface is not tied to specific ASIC. So we developed two drivers in parallel. Other vendors are now discussing with us, Cavium, Barefoot, Melons, they're all discussing with us how they should get in, how they should actually build their own driver for the system. But what I wanted basically to take you through is it's modular in the sense that we can plug any other ASIC. It's not built for Broadcom. Or anything like that. On the left side, things that I would like to highlight. Layer 3 protocols. We are using Quagga. So that's the protocol stack that we decided to use because that's the most live, I would say, open source stack. So that exists. We actually hired Paul Jackma. He's the maintainer of Quagga. So he will work on Quagga. Right, so his responsibility is to continue promoting Quagga because we're interested in the success of Quagga. Because that's the layer 3 protocol stack that we want to use. But he will also help us to actually take it correctly to the Quagga community, whatever we want to extend. And the main extension for us, for anything that we're taking from outside, is connection to the database. Basically integrated. So if you think about other company models, like Cumulus, you can install Quagga, you can install other things like LDP or anything. The problem is, from our perspective, but they think that that's an advantage, and we'll see how it works, is that the control plane is completely disintegrated. You configure monitoring, troubleshooting things separate differently. And so if you want to configure Quagga, you go to change some file, give it SIGUP, or you go to CLI, configure it. You want to configure LDP, it's a different thing. Right? It's different CLI, it's different configuration files, different ways of getting information. What is much more painful is monitoring stuff, not just configuring. Configuring, fine. I will write a few configuration files. Something crashes, something doesn't work. I would like to get the data from inside. Getting it in today's world, if you take Linux, it will be completely different things for everything. So we basically say, no, guys. It will take us a little bit longer to integrate, but we integrate everything with the database. So if you go into the database, I will take you, we'll show what happens inside. You will see information about temperature. You will see LDP stuff that we learned from the other people. You will see BGP routes. You will see everything. So everything is inside the database. It takes longer to integrate. So we are being asked sometimes, hey, can I just download this package and run it? Yes, you can if the only purpose is power sucking alien. If you actually wanted to be part of the system, you need to integrate to the database. It's not difficult. So we did it for Quagga, we did it for LDP, we did it for our own code. So for example, LACP daemon, we contributed. So we opened it from PVOS. From Virtual Connect product. So HP has implementations pretty much of everything. And we'll just keep contributing things that are missing in Linux. And we'll integrate them with the database. So layer 3 protocol we took from Quagga. Right now there's very interesting discussion happening on our mailing list, guys from NTT. They have Go BGP implementation. And they're mainly targeting EVPN, but they want to become a supercell of Quagga functionality. And we actually met at OCP, and we just discussed a little bit. And yesterday they published, hey, we actually started connecting it to the database. So we have already it working, right? So CLI, we can go into CLI of OpenSwitch, and it actually controls Go BGP. So it might be very interesting because, and we didn't expect this stuff. And so we just, okay, and I told them, hey guys, did you use the libraries from socket plane guys from Docker? And they say, yeah, we actually used them, we actually forked them, we extended them, and we integrated to OPS. So this is kind of the community work that we start seeing. So people just come out of the blue and they say, interesting, I have something, I would like to connect it. They actually found a bug and we fixed this bug in about 5 minutes and pushed it to the system and its continuous integration system tested it and like in 10 minutes we posted, okay, the bug is fixed. So it's very interesting and I will show a little bit the tools and everything that we actually use because we pretty much copied the infrastructure of OpenStack as is. It's all the Gerrit, Zool, everything. Right? So every commit goes through full continuous integration testing. Just like hundreds of tests, and they will talk a little bit about how we actually do these hundreds of tests, because for that you cannot run on the physical hardware if you want to do it on every commit.
So can we say like a basic example, just curious, you know, if it's Quagga today, you have those files to change, like you said. Now, if you're configuring Quagga on the system, how are you doing that?
So what we did, we basically took Quagga. So today, if you look at Quagga, it has Zebra, BGP daemon, all this stuff, right? And they're all talking to Zebra in order to send the routes, and CLI connects to every single daemon separately and provides commands into these daemons. But they said, no, sorry. Right now, each daemon connects to the database. Right? So the configuration for everything is inside the database. You publish routes to the database. Right? You subscribe to routes from the database. You make decisions about the routes. So BGP will publish the route in the database. Zebra will receive this route, and Zebra will make its selections. It's a tree manager. It makes selection of which route is the best. And all it will do, it will change some selected column on the route, say, from false to true. Now it's selected. Now switch daemon actually will receive this notification. Yes, it's selected. It will actually take to the ASIC. Right? So everything is going to be integrated in the database. We're now going through exercises of seeing what's the performance going to be.
And what I mean is like just a configuration state. So the initial configuration of Quagga, there's the conf files today that exist. So what, you know, if you're not touching a conf file, what are you configuring in this instance? Or do you still do that? And it's just as you're receiving routes and things like that, they're going to the OVSDB server. But I just mean like the initial configuration like of that.
So because it's all integrated now to the database, right, we have single initial configuration for the entire system, just like you're used with Cisco, Arista, or other places. We have full configuration. And you can do show running config. Why should I? You can do just show running config, and you receive the configuration. Right, for everything. So if you look at this running config, it has some configuration of LDP, some route map from Quagga, for BGP, stuff like that. Right? Now, by the way, we don't store configuration in CLI format. I will talk a little bit about it because CLI for us is not the main thing. We think that CLI is important, because people are used to it, people know how to use it, people really, you know, when I was at Cisco, we're thinking a lot about how to get rid. Nobody can get rid of it.
But when you are in the CLI, when you make a change there, is it going straight to the database and making the change like instantly?
So when CLI goes to the database, okay. Right? So let me go back to this slide. So, sorry, not this one. So as you see, all the management daemons, CLI, REST, whatever you connect, they don't talk to the daemon, to the other daemons. They don't talk to Quagga. They talk to the database model. They change tables and columns, and that's it. And so if tomorrow I want to build some new interface, let's say you want to build tomorrow Juno-style CLI. Okay, build it, connect it to the database, and that's it. Right? You don't have to talk to anybody else. So BGPD is subscribing to these tables and columns from database. That's my configuration. Right? It's not talking to CLI. It's not talking to REST API. It's not talking to anybody else. That everybody talks to the database and subscribe to it for the information from the database. So if we touch CLI, let's talk about a little bit about it. So our conception, the way we see it is CLI is very much needed. Networking guys know it, they're used to it, and it's something that is needed. And you know, when I'm going to configure Linux, like networking pieces, I miss it, kind of. Right? I'm used to getting the CLI, run 5 commands, I got configure something, and do write mem, and I'm done. And I'm going to different files and stuff, and then I'm thinking about the next steps about high availability and how should I mirror stuff. We're getting into interesting points. So we want to have CLI. So we said day one, we'll have CLI. All the functionality will actually implement the CLI. So right now, whenever somebody adds a feature, from our team or from the external teams when they come in, we basically say, guys, you have to connect to CLI as well. You have to provide CLI commands. Now, but we don't think that CLI should be used the way it was necessarily used before, like for scripting. That's terrible. Right? So if you are DevOps, if you want to actually script the box in some way, it's terrible to use CLI, mainly to parse the outputs. And every time this output changes, all of your scripts are gone. Right, so we want to provide more of the programmable interfaces, and there are quite a few programmable interfaces. So the very basic programmable interface for the system is actually OpenSwitch protocol. Right, that's the 70547 RFC that VMware guys actually.
The most lowest level. Right?
That's the yes, exactly. That's the really lowest level. So all these daemons, they talk to the database over this protocol.
Right.
So as I'm trying to explain to people, that's more for the integration purposes. Right, so if you have some external system that wants to integrate with the switch in more tighter way, that's a really good way. Right, because you are from the outside, you can see exactly the same thing that the daemons from the inside can see. In fact, I can take some of the daemons and put them outside. And they will still, instead of doing Unix domain sock, they will do TCP connection, which is fine. But obviously, I'm not going to push people, hey, you have to learn this protocol and start doing it. So we can implement the REST API, which is pretty much a shim on top of the database itself, right? So it takes a schema and it exposes the schema through HTTP REST API calls. And it's not trivial. There are some interesting translations in order to make this REST API more useful. And I will show the REST API. We actually started working on Ansible right now. Oh, before Ansible, we also have what we call declarative interface, which means you provide full JSON of the system. And this JSON completely explains the system. And you can read it or you can write it. Actually, whenever we do copy running config startup config, what we store in the startup config is a JSON. It's not CLI. And so if you do show startup config in CLI, you'll see CLI. But you'll notice there's some 2-3 seconds delay as we actually convert JSON into all these CLIs back. And it's interesting how we do it because we actually map it into some backup database and do show running config on this database. But basically, at the end of the day, what I'm trying to communicate is that the CLI is not the main one. For example, we don't store startup config in CLI. We store it in this declarative way of JSON. And through REST API, you can actually fetch this entire JSON. You can write this entire JSON. We also have utility inside the system that you can provide this JSON, and it will actually put it. And what it actually tells you is that the system itself is declarative. Right? So what is inside database is declaration of intent. This is what I want to have. right? And the system is supposed to align to this situation. So daemons will subscribe to different pieces, they will actually learn stuff, they will make decisions, they will publish stuff in the database. It's a chain reaction, things happen. At the end of the day, it either happens or don't, or doesn't happen, and if it doesn't happen, then statuses will go into the database saying, hey, this one doesn't really work. This VLAN is actually down. Right? Why? Because there are no interfaces attached to this VLAN. So that's the system decision. So we already have CLI, we have REST API, we have...
One more question on the CLI. So is the CLI talking to the database directly, or is it going through the REST interface?
To the database directly. Yes.
I have one follow-up on that. Just to back up, I want to make sure I heard you right. Did I hear you say that the daemons could either connect directly to the database like you showed them there, or via TCP connection?
So OpenSDB server has the ability to talk to you either on the local Unix domain socket, or it will just open TCP listening socket and will listen for anybody else. So by default, we don't open the external, the TCP connection. We open only Unix domain socket connection. The protocol is the same. Essentially, it's all the same, just the performance. So if you're inside the system, you use Unix domain sockets. It's local IPC mechanism inside the Linux. And if you're outside, obviously, open TCP connection. And it's configurable, so you can open.
Why not use REST for the CLI to simplify the development in terms of database, you know?
So basically what happens is, if you think about it, if you have to choose whether to go REST or to go OpenSDB, REST provides you more convenient way, but it's more limited way. Right? Because, for example, with OpenSDB, you have very, very flexible subscription mechanisms. So I would like to subscribe to this specific column only if there's specific value and stuff like that. With REST API, you're much more restricted in the ways that you can actually do it. We will have events for REST API, right? So it's completely on the roadmap to have even two styles of events, one for the management systems, where the REST daemon will actually do post to the management system, will say, hey, something happened, or, you know, like web sockets and stuff like that for the UIs and stuff like that. But it's more restricted. That doesn't matter. At the end of the day, it's more restricted. So if you really want it to be tightly integrated into the system, which is most of the daemons want, and CLI also wants to be integrated with this.
Chef up there, is Chef going through REST or is Chef?
Chef we still didn't do. We'll see how it does. For example, for Ansible, good chance we'll actually put it on top of declarative, right? And declarative goes to the database.
How is that exposed out of the box to declarative? Is that via another API?
Declarative today, you can access it either through REST API, for example. There is a full configuration resource that you can go, or there is even a utility inside the system that provides access to declarative configuration. Because Ansible by itself is declarative. That's the whole point of here's what it is and please make it happen. So it might be very convenient to actually do it. The way it actually happened is that last week or 10 days ago, we actually published, hey, we're going to work on Ansible, and director of engineering from Ansible reached out, hey guys, let me help you. So, okay, nice, let's work. So we immediately scheduled IRC chat, and our developer actually got into IRC chat, he did the design, discussed it, and then architects from LinkedIn reached out into this IRC chat, hey guys, I have automation scenarios, let's talk about it. Let's actually develop them. And you know what, we don't care which scenarios to treat first, so hey, you have nice scenarios, let's work on them. Let's create these scenarios. So that's the community, again, that we are trying to actually create for the entire thing. Okay, so Ansible might go over declarative, for example. Monitoring daemons. Daemons that take information out of the system to anybody. Again, they subscribe to a database, subscribe to whatever they want to subscribe, and they are free to take information out, whether it's SNMP, or, for example, interesting implementation that we got from Broadcom. They actually contributed their Broadview implementation, where the ASIC detects microbursts, basically, in hardware, and it exports this information to the database, and they put Broadview daemon that fetches it from the database and takes it out. So for us, it was very important to verify that it's easy to connect systems to the database. Right, so when we actually want to integrate many, many different systems to the database. System daemons, that's just daemons that manipulate the state in some case, may decide whether the interface should really go up or should remain down. That's those, like, logic, just business kind of logic. This error actually worth explanation. Everything, when I say everything is inside database, I mean all the state of the system is inside database. Packets are not states, Right? So I don't want to push packets through the database. And initially, in the initial discussions, they were like, oh, okay, let's push everything. Okay, why? You know, packet is not a state, and they're going to kill the database immediately. So what happens is that ASIC-specific kernel driver, right now, for example, for Broadcom, Knet, so if anybody familiar, basically creates virtual interface inside the kernel. So if you go into Linux today, and if you do ifconfig, you will see the interfaces. You will see all the interfaces. So packets are going into the interfaces and are fetched by the protocol daemons the same way they're fetched inside Linux. In a sense, for example, you can do with the system, just like you can probably do with Arista and others on Cumulus, you can put the speed amp on these interfaces, you can see all the control plane packets flowing up and down, that's okay, because basically we are using exactly the same mechanisms. BGPD just opens TCP socket and listens, right? Or opens TCP socket and goes out. I had no purpose to actually go and no intention to implement TCP stack myself or something like that. So we actually just reuse kernel TCP stack. It will be interesting journey as we go forward because some of the features on the slow pass, they may want to intercept some of the packets like protect OSPF, hellos, and stuff like that, and we'll have to provide this mechanism. We'll have to discuss how to do it. But that's the whole direction.
So the front panel ports on the switch appear as IP Route 2 network interfaces? Or
So if you go, exactly. So if you go, if you do IP Route, I think I should be able to show it. Just, so here, let's go to Linux. So if you do ifconfig here, you would only see management interface. Right? And the reason is because we have to separate the traffic of management from the data. So we actually create namespaces, right? They're not very surprising. We just use namespaces. And the namespace that holds these interfaces should be IP NetNS. Exec SWNS IP. Let me see if it actually shows on this one. No, it doesn't show. This is inside the container. We'll see. I'm not sure that it's in the same namespace. I'll find it later. But yes, if you go to the real switch and you go to SWNS namespace, you will see all these interfaces inside. In fact, when we will create tunnels and other things and VLAN interfaces, they also show up. Because, again, control plane has to fetch packets from them, right? So the packets have to come to the kernel. So we create all the interfaces in the system. Now, ASIC driver is responsible to create just the interfaces for the physical ports. But other daemons are creating all the rest. For example, if you need to create VLAN interfaces on top of them, right? So all the sub-interface and stuff, tunnels, those are created by the daemons. They are not. It's not supposed to be on the driver. What else do we have on this diagram? Color coding a little bit, just to give a sense of what is reused from other systems versus what we actually integrated. So obviously this server is completely reused, but now we have probably 5-6 engineers that are looking into how to optimize it, performance, scale it, all this stuff. VMware guys, they're also working on it very heavily because they actually use it in OVN. So we are very aligned on the future of this server. We want to make it much faster and want it to actually be a very important piece of the system. So obviously this server we take from others. All these kernel pieces we basically take from the existing parts. We took, so where you see two colors, you actually see this frame. It means that we integrate with database. So Quagga, we didn't make any changes to Quagga itself. In fact, right now that Paul Jackman is working on taking it up directly into Quagga, we want to develop everything upstream. We don't want to develop anything. We don't want to have any forks inside the system. So we have somebody that works on making open vSwitch, for example, upstream, right? Because we made changes, and we are now working on actually upstreaming all these things. We want to only have our own extensions, and we don't want to have any copy-paste from open vSwitch. We want to manage all these OVSDB server improvements. We'll upstream patches, and then we'll downstream it back to us. That's all I had on this diagram.
Broadcom NDAs?
Broadcom, okay. Traditionally, Broadcom would say the SDK source is closed and API is closed, right? That's the traditional Broadcom way of doing it. So basically, it would mean for us that we cannot open source the driver for Broadcom. And we said, no, we are not going to work this way because the driver is supposed to be open, right? So Broadcom, about around the same time, they started opening the API and what they called OpenSSL project. So OpenSSL is basically one-to-one mapping of Broadcom SDK API. They have intentions to actually take it out to OCP and work, and you know, it will start diverting from Broadcom SDK one-to-one. But right now, this is what it is. And we worked with them very, very tightly, or very kind of closely, on adding additional APIs to OpenSSL. And they're very, very responsive. So, you know, for us, the average turnaround for getting additional APIs from Broadcom SDK open sourced was about 4 days. Right? So we send an email, hey guys, we actually missed this API. It takes about 4 days, and we get a new drop of these APIs that are open now. So it was really, really good. So right now, what happens is that this driver, we have this open, if you go into Git, you will see OPSWitchD OpenSSL plugin repository, right? And it has the driver for on top of OpenSSL. It doesn't use anything which is not open in SDK. It just uses OpenSSL properly. Now, the code itself, the API is open, the code itself is closed sourced. So that one we actually build inside HP. We have the licensing agreements with Broadcom to actually for us to build it, to build the image, and we publish the binary to the open. So the driver here is open, is open source. You can see completely the driver. The SDK itself is closed. So this is the only piece. Right now there are some improvements that we're going through to get them from Broadcom about platform initialization code. So we don't have to build this binary for every platform that we want to support. We want to take this platform initialization code out of there. And they're working on how to actually make it happen without exposing their own intellectual property, right, from their own SDK.
Switch abstraction interface. So Microsoft and Dell have partnered to say you shouldn't be building custom ASIC drivers for this. You should have a universally defined interface called the switch abstraction, the SAI.
So we have a little bit different standpoint on this stuff. We are basically saying, as a network operating system, we are agnostic to what the API is. And we will let, because the system is going to be community driven and open, we'll basically let every vendor to build the driver that they want. Right? So because at the end of the day, ASICs are not equal. There are different flexibilities and capabilities in different ASICs. And we don't want to bring them to lowest common denominator in any way. So we basically say, okay, guys, you know what? This interface is going to be pretty much a superset. And right now on the mailing list, we're discussing how to make it modular so you can include features and stuff like that. But at the end of the day, this is kind of a superset. You guys put your driver, and we don't care if you actually take it to your own SDK API or you take it to Sai. So now that we're talking to Cavium, Barefoot, Mellanox, they're thinking about, basically we told them, hey guys, you have three options. One option is you may implement OpenSSL API on top of your SDK, and then you don't need to develop any driver. Just plug it in and it will work because we already developed driver and we'll keep developing it because Broadcom is the most prevalent platform in the market. The other option is you can cooperate and develop side driver. The third option is develop your own driver. We don't care. Right? So you know what is best for your system, for your ASIC. Make it work the best way you can. Right? And you're interested. So we'll not be in your way and we'll not enforce you, hey, you have to be in Sai. Because it will hit some of these ASIC vendors because they're trying to provide some additional value of what they know. And they have different architectures, they invest into it, and now we are saying, no, you just work as is, as you know. So we are taking this standpoint of we are agnostic. So you build the driver, you maintain it, right? Otherwise it will not work on your platform. So, you know, not HP, not anybody else will sell it to your platform. But so we believe in kind of alignment of interests. So once the interests are aligned, they will do the right thing for them.